Knowledge, which has become the most important element of today's world, and the information society that emerged as a result of this, has changed the structure of power and the knowledgeable one has become powerful, while there was a power system based on the body in the past. Communities have entered an enormous race for knowledge and development. While information is so important, reaching it quickly has become one of the greatest goals of all humanity. Of course, by reaching information here, what we mean is to reach permanent information quickly. If you say that I read so many books, researchers, articles, I lick and swallow everything, but I can't remember, you are in the right place. If I ask you what you ate at noon a week ago, what would your answer be? And if I ask you what he did on his birthday last year? Our brain has an incredible capacity, our only task is to use it in the right way. So how is it that our brain cannot remember what we ate a week ago, but remembers what we did on our day of birth months ago like it was yesterday? For the answers to these, let's focus first on how our brain works. Our brain consists of three intertwined parts. 1. Primitive brain. This is the innermost part of our brain and is present in all human beings and animals. It is it that gives the command, fight, or escape, in case of danger, as the name indicates. 2. Middle brain. This part is the basis of all our emotions. It is the part that is indispensable for our learning and permanent memory. There is a part called the hippocampus in this part, which is the part that decides whether the information will be transferred to the permanent memory of our brain. Clive Waring, one of the music authorities of the BBC, caught the herpes simplex virus at the height of his career. While most of those caught with this type of virus survived the disease with cold sores on their lips, the virus transmitted to Waring reached the brain and carried the inflammation to this area and caused the brain to be damaged. This condition, called encephalitis disease, caused very important changes in Waring's memory structure. Waring, who could only recall events in the last minute or two and constantly felt as if he had just woken up from a long deep sleep, greeted him as if he hadn't seen him for a long time when his wife left the room and returned 2 or 3 minutes later. Waring says, "I feel like a living dead, and can easily remember all the events related to his life before he got sick, as well as preserving his musical abilities, can read notes and play musical instruments." Experts state that the hippocampus is completely destroyed due to Waring's disease, and therefore he cannot keep any new information in his memory, and they state that he is not affected by this disease because other knowledge and skills in his memory are stored in different parts of the brain. 3. Cortex. It is the top part of our brain. It has a curved structure. After the decision of the hippocampus, permanent information is recorded in this section. Apart from that, seeing, sniffing, speaking, etc. Many events take place in this section. We can consider this section as a place for processing and recording information. The cortex consists of two parts, the right lobe and the left lobe. While the right lobe is on imagination and abstract things, the left lobe rules functions on concrete things like logic, mathematics. These lobes are connected to each other with a region containing dense nerve fibers called the corpus callosum. This section is also the part that provides the flow of information. Real learning is learning using both lobes at the same time. Let's come back to the questions I asked above, why we do not remember what we ate 1 week ago, but we remember very well something we did months ago. This is because the hippocampus sees food as unnecessary information and does not save it in permanent memory, but instead sees your birthday as useful information and saves it in permanent memory. So, how does the hippocampal keep information in permanent and temporary memory? The answer to this is simple. In fact, since the brain is two lobes, we have to do two lobes to learn. We forget what we do because we usually spend our daily life routinely. This learning is often left lobe based. We look at everything logically, and therefore it quickly goes out of our mind when we do not use the right lobe. Or we dream that does not fit any logic, has no connection with reality, and we forget it the next day, which is a learning style using only the right lobe. You say good, you say beautiful, I can hear you say how it will be. We have provided a lot of scientific information so far, let's see how to use them in our lives. I don't know, do you remember the noble gases? Well, if I told you, heap random, what CMI, KR, without R, SIP, RN, or you probably remember it without saying me. Another example is the pistachio sahap, discard the vowels, you get the letters that make consonant similarities. The logic of these is very simple, we put a very ridiculous sentence or word in a logical order, as we use both of our lobes. These were known examples. For example, is your name memory bad? Let's give an example immediately. How do we code a person whose name is Ahmet? I thought of a Ahmet who called R. Imagine Ahmet when he was shooting R, or someone whose name is Osumon is AAAAAASU. Someone came to say, imagine that Osumon said quadruple A water. These are a few simple examples that can be reproduced further. While learning a foreign language, we need to memorize words and sit down and repeat them all for days. We memorize it, but we forget it as soon as 1 to 2 months pass. Using these methods, especially in foreign language learning, will be very much easier by placing words in our permanent memory. For example, the meaning of the word vanish is to disappear. There is also a cleaner called vanish. You know that if you think and imagine the dirt as disappears when using vanish, it will settle in your permanent memory. Another example is terminate ending word meaning. Think of it as the terminal and imagine the trip finished in the terminal. Yes, you will have a hard time doing these things, but remember. Instead of sitting down and memorizing it straight, then if you make associations with that time, the words you memorize will settle in your permanent memory. In short, if learning is done by using both lobes of the brain at the same time, it is saved in permanent memory. In addition, information is processed by the connection between neurons in the brain. For example, if a newly learned information has a connection with old information, the relevant neurons immediately connect with new information neurons, and the more connections are established, the stronger the learning. One of the greatest examples of this is the Pythagorean theorem. This is the first to be given since we started learning geometry. A2 plus B2 equals C2. It has been used so much, the neurons are so connected that we have memorized this equation as much as our name. In order to learn anything permanently, here are the things that should be done. 1. While learning, both lobes of the brain should be used. 2. Learning with both lobes should be repeated when necessary. In addition, the brain can concentrate on one subject for 40 to 50 minutes at most, then the concentration begins to decrease. Studying a subject for 3 hours without interruption will do more harm than good. During the pause, nothing should be taken care of. It has probably happened to you hundreds of times. You think about something so much, you concentrate, then while you are dealing with something, it is as if a light flashes in your brain and you immediately think of something creative about that subject. Always use the magic of taking a break. The brain both rests and stacks the information it learns when the pause is paused. This stacking is realized as neurons connecting with each other, as we mentioned above. Speaking of stacking, the brain, as you know most, works asleep. This is why sleeping is so crucial to the stacking of what we are studying while taking any exam. Some information about the brain. Our brain is approximately 1.4 kilogram. It weighs 1,369 grams and resembles a walnut. It has the capacity to save, process and program 600 units of information per second in our memory over a period of 85 years. This is 3,600 bits per minute, 2,160,000 bits per hour and 51,840,000 bits per day, as computer area unit 0.1000 bit equals 1 MB. More than $300 trillion is needed to build a machine that resembles a human brain. In order for such a machine to work, 1 trillion watt of electrical energy is needed. However, the machine to be built will not be able to exceed the potential of the human brain. Everyone's brain is the size of 2 clenched fists. Billions of facts and dreams that pass through our brains fill 90 million thick books. There are more than 100 billion cells working in a human brain. There are around 10 to 14 billion nerve cells in our brain. The information storage capacity is between 1 and 2 million bits. During its lifetime, the brain's information storage capacity is 10 new information units per second. This means that it can store 600 new information per minute and 36,000 bits of information per hour. During a normal lifetime, a human brain has the capacity to store 100 trillion bits of information. The average adult brain can store 500 times the information contained in the Britannica Encyclopedia. It has been calculated that the network of all telephone systems in the world will occupy a fraction the size of an ordinary pea if compared correctly with your brain.